All right, well, good afternoon. We are glad to be with you again this afternoon. My name is Bob, joined here with Todd, and today we are welcoming you to Edifying the Saints, a podcast here, which is a ministry of Maranatha Bible Church, which is located in Comstock Park, just outside of Grand Rapids, Michigan. So we are continuing our talk this afternoon on progressive Christianity. Just to rehash a little bit about what we talked about last time, we talked a little bit about what progressive Christianity is, what it looks like, and some of the tenets of it, and we also talked about looking at what they see as opposed to a high view of the Bible. They have a very low view of Scripture, and then we also talked about looking at how they view their feelings actually above and beyond the facts or the truth within Scripture. So is there anything else that you wanted to add to that we covered last time?
Yeah, no, I think it's good. I think it's helpful, though, to remind ourselves why we're talking about this topic. We mentioned this last time, but we are talking about progressive Christianity because it is fast becoming a large part of so-called evangelicalism, and I wouldn't even put them within the bounds of evangelicalism anymore. But whereas the emergent church, you know, a number of years ago was more on the periphery and more on the fringes of evangelicalism, what we're seeing today is now that same kind of mentality that is driving progressive Christianity is now kind of driving all of evangelicalism.
Right.
And so I think that's why we're concerned about this. This you can go anywhere in the country now and you can find churches that will identify as progressive Christians. And you can find many progressive Christians all over in various parts of the church. And so it's just infiltrating our world. And that's why we need to be aware of this.
Yeah, and as it's infiltrating our world, I think it's important to realize this isn't just at the church level, like the normal church attenders. We're talking church leaders, we're talking seminary professors, presidents, to where you are now hard-pressed to find what we would call a traditional, evangelical, fundamental, whatever label you want to put, seminary that simply teaches Scripture for what it actually is, which is, you know, the inspired Word of God.
And the same thing is true for churches.
And the same thing is true for churches,
you're finding fewer and fewer churches that are standing for Orthodox Christianity.
Right.
And, you know, we're becoming dinosaurs, right?
Yeah.
Really, we're becoming almost not extinct, because the Lord always has his remnant, of course. And there are many faithful churches that are still holding fast to the Word of God across the country, and we're thankful for that. But we want to be one of those.
We do.
And we don't want to capitulate to culture. And we want to stand where others who have gone before us have stood in terms of faithfully defending the Word of God and doing that unashamedly and not capitulating to the false ideas of culture. And so for all of those reasons, we believe this is critical, because the pressure is going to mount, and there's going to be an increasing amount of opposition, even coming from those circles towards us who are more orthodox, I guess you would say. And so we just have to be aware of it. We shouldn't be surprised by it, because this is the way it's always been.
Right.
But it is something that we need to be constantly aware of.
That's good. So we're going to continue on. As I said last week, we looked at our faith over facts, or feelings over facts, and then how they have a low view of Scripture. So we're going to continue on with the last three of these kind of ideologies that they hold to. And the first one being essential Christian doctrines are open for reinterpretation. And so this is to me probably the most dangerous of the five, as we are reinterpreting what we would consider essential Christian doctrines. So we're not talking about you believe in the continuation of the gifts and somebody else is a cessationist. Both those people can be saved.
Pre-trib rapture, post-trib rapture.
Right. The recreation of the earth or just a renewed earth, right? These kind of things. So that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about actual historic doctrines that you place your flag in, and you're saying, I'm an evangelical because I believe in this. I just want to read you just a little section here. Union Seminary President Serene Jones, she says that progressive Christianity is in line with the likes of the Protestant Reformation, because it's allowing people to have a new way of thinking. And the church needs to, quote unquote, envision and build something new. And so looking around, this is a Union Seminary, this is a large seminary, popular seminary, and it's not uncommon. This isn't an anomaly. This is what many seminaries are going to in some form or fashion. They might not come out like Union did and say we support progressive Christianity, but they certainly support some of the tenets of progressive Christianity.
That statement is just shocking.
It is shocking.
I mean, we are not dealing with Protestant Reformation doctrines here.
Right.
We are dealing with the aberration of those, with the turning over of those doctrines. I mean, Luther and Calvin, if they would see what is being done today within progressive Christianity, they'd roll over in their grave because these are the things they fought and many of those reformers died for.
That's right.
So we are not in any way consistent with Reformation doctrine in terms of progressive Christianity.
That's absolutely correct. And so in Grand Rapids, I just did a cursory search, nothing in depth or whatever. There are dozens of churches on their website actually say we are a progressive church, right? And so one of their quotes was, our faith is a dynamic experience. Now, notice this right there, right? A dynamic meaning it's changing. Experience means that it's subjected unto you. So it's a dynamic experience that shifts and evolves for us. So our faith shifts and evolves for us. I mean, we could talk hours just about that statement. And especially for a child growing leaps and bounds in their development. So they're saying your faith has this kind of growth to it, which we would actually agree. You certainly do grow in your faith, but it's not growing in dynamic experiences that you can subject unto yourself. It says we cannot capture that experience and box it into a set of prepositions to memorize and defend that limits and denies the realities of the human experience. Mm. So where do you want to start with that?
Where do we start? I mean, that statement, we cannot box it into a set of propositions to memorize and defend. That's what faithful believers through the ages have done.
That's right.
We have studied the Word of God. We have come to conviction about the Word of God. We have believed that it is objective truth. It's not subjective. It's not based on feelings and emotions and experiences. We have gone to the Word of God, and over 2,000 years and more, there's been a formulation of the orthodox tenets of the Christian faith that are communicated in propositions.
That's right.
That we will defend, and many of those we will go to the mat for, and we will die on the hill of those propositions because we believe in things like the sufficiency of Scripture and in the fact that Christ is the only way to heaven and the one true gospel that saves people and the reality of hell. These are the propositions that they're denying.
That's right.
And so when you say that we can't capture those things in propositions, it is an undoing of the very things that the church has done for millennia to categorize what we believe the Scriptures teach in a systematic fashion. And so, yeah, that is very problematic.
Yeah, and you notice here at the end of the quote, that limits and denies the realities of the human experience. And so it's like, they want to add in their experience to what it is. And so the problem with that is we all have different experiences, right? And so my experience can't be true and your experience be true. Like there's only one truth. And so some of those doctrines you said that we would die for, some of those propositions, first of all, the full deity of Christ, the authority of Scripture, substitutionary atonement, existence of hell, truth, goodness of biblical heteronormative sexuality, all these things now actually progressives deny, reject, or as we'll see in a moment, they actually just define a different way, right? So like deity of Christ, why is that important? Why do we need to stand on the hill and die for the deity of Christ?
If Christ is not God and man in human flesh in one body, we have no Savior. That's as simple as that. If Christ is not the perfect combination of the God-man, fully God, fully man, you know, incarnate in human flesh, deity incarnate in human flesh. If that's not true, then he was not our substitute. And if he was not our substitute, which they're going to take issue with that view of the atonement, which we'll talk about in just a moment, then we have no Savior. And if we have no Savior, we're still in our sin. If we're still in our sin, we're still hopeless.
That's right.
So if you take away the deity of Christ, you have stripped the redemptive work of God to rescue sinners from his wrath and hell, you strip that of all of its power. If that's true, then he was just a man.
That's right.
Who lived a good life and gave us a moral example to follow, and that's it. So that strikes at the very core of God's plan to rescue sinners.
So when you take away the the deity of Jesus, then you can also easily take away original sin, which is what they do. So if Adam hasn't passed down that sin to us, then we have no reason for Jesus to be Son of God, fully God, fully man, because we're not sinners. Now, progressive Christians will tell you, yes, we sin, but they actually replace that original sin with what's been called original blessing.
Right.
Right? We're all blessed because we're made in the image of God, and we can do good things by being a good person. But the Bible obviously has a different narrative to that. The authority of Scripture, and we talked about that a little bit last week, looking down on the Bible. But why is it important that we hold to that? Like, as a church, you go into a church, there's people watching who go to a church that, maybe the authority of Scripture is not as high as it should be. Why is it important that we have the authority of Scripture in the believer's life?
Well, it comes down to authority. The issue is ultimate authority. Who has the ultimate authority to tell us what we need to believe and what we should believe about God and ourselves and eternity? And who defines truth? Mm. It comes back to that. Who is our authority? Who defines truth? Who is the one that is able to say, this is true and this is false? Well, if you abandon the authority of Scripture, then you have set aside the one singular objective authority by which all other opinions and experiences are evaluated. Mm. If that's not there, then everyone's just bringing to the table their own opinions, their own thoughts, their own ideas. This is postmodernism. This is right. Why the emergent church was so widely accepted, because you get to just believe what you want to believe.
Right.
And so if that's the case, then there is no objective authority. There's no canon. There's no standard. There's no rule by which everything can be evaluated. And our, obviously, as we talked about last time, we believe in the authority of Scripture. And we believe that God has spoken in his word, and he has spoken authoritatively.
That's right.
So that's why it's serious.
And then the existence of hell. So this is actually rejected by progressive Christianity. much actually like a lot of faith-based preachers, right, the Joel Osteens and even Jehovah's Witnesses, they would say that there is no hell because, they would say, obviously, a good God's not going to send people to hell, and hell has been around, or hell has been taught to scare people to come into heaven, right? And so they do take a hard stance on saying that there is no hell. Why is it important that we fully believe that there's a hell as a Bible-believing Christian?
Well, the Bible says it.
I don't know.
I mean, the Bible tells us much about hell. Jesus spoke more about hell than he did heaven.
Yeah.
So if you're gonna deny hell, which is what Rob Bell, we're all familiar. This was what he came out and very vehemently denied. If you deny hell, you deny the clear authority and teaching of Scripture. But secondarily, I think you minimize the holiness of God.
Right.
If you say there's no hell, then you have a problem with who God is, and you have to then redefine God, which is what we're getting at here. This is what they're doing. They're redefining terms. They're redefining God.
That's right.
God is a God of wrath. He hates sin. He hates unholiness. He hates anything that violates his character. And so to deny hell is to deny not only the clear teaching of Scripture, it is to malign the character of God. He must punish sin. Because he wouldn't be God. He can't be God who just turns a blind eye to sin and say, well, it's no big deal. Let's just pretend it didn't happen. No, in his holiness and in his righteousness and in his wrath, he has to punish sin. And so it is really an abomination of the character of God.
Yeah, so it comes down to, as much as they want to espouse that they have this super high view of God, this super
loving
God, they've actually taken God and lowered him to their standards.
Absolutely.
Because as you said, if there's no hell, then how can we look at the holiness of God? Because if he doesn't have to punish sin, then he's just your buddy,
right,
that you get to hang out with.
Right.
And then progressive Christianity talks about penal substitutionary atonement. So penal substitutionary atonement is something that we hold on to quite dearly, I would say. And there's been talk over the last several years about the penal substitutionary atonement. And it has come really to the surface in the last decade or so, this little phrase that's called the cosmic child abuse. So just to give a brief outline, that's God sending his son Jesus to die, and Jesus dying on the cross is God abusing his son. And so they say there is no way that this could happen. That can't happen, because if that happened, then God is actually a proponent of abuse, and he's pushing abuse, and he's looking down. How can that be real love? So I want to talk about this, because that's really a big stumbling block. And people think, you know, when they say that, you see people say this, and they feel like they get one up on you. Like, oh, so you're saying God is a child abuser? Is that the God that you worship? So let's talk about this. First of all, you want to describe briefly penal substitutionary atonement, and then we'll look at the necessity of it.
Well, penal substitutionary atonement is the belief and the conviction that Scripture clearly teaches that Christ died as our substitute. That God in human flesh, Jesus Christ, as he was hanging on the cross, he received the full brunt of God's wrath against sin. And he didn't deflect it, he absorbed it. He experienced it in full. He experienced hell, as it were, as he was hanging on the cross. So what he was doing in those moments was he was propitiating our sin. He was taking the wrath for sin that God must demonstrate, and he was experiencing it in full in himself. He drank the cup in full. He absorbed the full wrath of God for those hours that he was hanging on the cross. He experienced hell, as it were, in our place. Mm-hmm. And so that is at the heart and the core of the gospel,
yeah.
Right? That's what we believe about the gospel, that there is a substitute, a price has been paid, an atonement has been accomplished for us, so that anyone who places their faith and trust in Christ does not need to experience and will never experience that wrath anymore. That is the glory of penal substitutionary atonement.
Yeah, so I think if you take away hell and you take away original sin, then you don't have sin that needs to be punished. So a natural outworking of not holding to those historic beliefs would be that, well, then you don't need to have that that substitution. You don't have to have that. There is no propitiation because God's not mad at you. So if God's not mad at you, then there doesn't have to be Jesus. So then you can cut that off at the knees. And so you can start to see how a belief, when you take one of those threads out, just one of those essential Christian doctrines, the rest of them have to fall in order to stay consistent with the lie that you're believing. And so as you see penal substitutionary, and I found this on Ligonier's website, and it said, it is the clearest picture of the kind of God we serve, one who holds nothing back in order to redeem his children. In sending his son to bear his wrath, the Father seeks the glory of the Son. I thought that was so succinctly put, that God didn't do this thing willy-nilly. We actually read at the appointed time, right? And so we know that God had this in mind, the Trinity had this in mind, the moving forward, and when that time came, when God saw the fullness of time, Christ came, and then he was handed over as God had planned out. And so we would say this is certainly not cosmic child abuse in any stretch of the imagination, nor do we believe that God promotes child abuse, obviously. But we have to hold to this. Otherwise, as you said, we have no hope. We're still dead in our sins, and we're going to be judged, and we're going to experience that wrath.
And again, it's connected to their view of God. If their view of God is love, and there's a minimization of him as a God of also wrath, of course they're going to reject this.
Right.
But, you know, as we've said before, the cross is where we see the love and the wrath of God collide.
Yeah.
You know, it's one of the most wonderful displays of both. They come together at the cross. And on the one hand, God cannot ignore sin. He must punish it. On the other hand, he is a loving God who wants to rescue sinners from their sin. And so both of those collide at the cross of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
And so it is a core central doctrine of the gospel. And if you strip the gospel of that, you have just emasculated the gospel.
You have no good news.
There's no good news. Yeah. All you have is he's a good example and He sacrificed himself for others. That's all you have. Sure. There is no divine rescue. There is no way that sinners can be exempt from the wrath of God. So,
right.
No, this is a serious error in redefining this historic doctrine.
Absolutely. So some of the things that you may hear in the resurrection of Jesus doesn't have to be factual to speak truth. So they're starting to, you know, look at those doctrines. The church's historic position on sexuality is archaic and needs to be updated with a modern framework. I mean, that sounds really smart, but it's just wrong. The idea of a literal hell is offensive to non-Christians and needs to be reinterpreted. I would agree. The idea of a literal hell is offensive to non-Christians. It doesn't need to be reinterpreted. It needs to be paired with the gospel,
exactly.
Right? So now let's look at, we looked at some doctrines that they would deny. And so now we're going to look at some historic terms. So you have to understand how all of this fits together, because you can't hold on to the words and their original meanings if you're not going to hold on to the doctrines that those words kind of make up, you could say. And so, first of all, Jesus died for you, or Jesus died for your sins. The progressive church would say that's psychologically damaging. So this is one of the reasons why they say you can't tell somebody that they're not born the way that they are, whether it be homosexual or transgender, whatever that is. Because now you're psychologically damaging them by telling them that they're in sin. So that's why you have to take that kind of verbiage out. Mm. God intended for Jesus to die. This is confusing and jarring is what it says. This is right off the progressivechristianity.com. Like, I think that's actually the literal website. And so to tell someone that God intended Jesus to die, you have to explain to them, how would a father want his son to die? So once again, we're taking these biblical principles and bringing them down and saying, you know, us in our sinful way is going to kind of hopefully re-explain what God did. And then lastly, Jesus died to save them from God's judgment, which is what you were talking about. And so I found this fascinating. An atonement theology of inborn corruption, which we would say original sin, in need of redemption, has no place in conversation with kids about Easter. So Easter has nothing to do with Jesus. Easter has nothing to do with original sin. It has nothing to do with the death and resurrection of Christ. All it has to do with is bunny and eggs, however we got to bunnies and eggs. So that's what they would say. So they're starting to redefine these terms.
Yeah. So it's just unfortunate. Not only are historic doctrines being redefined, we've got historic terms that are being redefined. And so this is a semantics thing, and I think that's what's critical here. Is this is what makes progressive Christianity, I think, so confusing for so many people, that in many cases they're using the same terms.
Right.
They're using the same verbiage. They're practicing the same ordinances. They're baptizing. They're having communion. They're opening the Bible. They don't hold to it in the same way we do. But in many cases, it looks kind of like historic Christianity. And that, yet when you dig into it, you find out they mean different things by the terms that they're using. And so that's what makes this such a deceptive deception by Satan himself, that he's taking what is historically true and he's twisting it enough so that still it has some vestiges of what is true, but is now just stripped of its biblical meaning.
Right.
And I think that's why it's so deceptive and so dangerous for anyone to get caught up in the progressive Christianity environment, because they're not meaning the same things that we're meaning when we use the same terms.
And on the heels of that, I was reading about progressive Christians say that, yes, the Bible is inspired. And here's, however, they believe the Bible is inspired in the same way and on the same level as Christian books, songs, and sermons. So if you ask one, is the Bible inspired? They'd say, absolutely. Just like I sit down and I think of a song that I want to write, or I'm singing something and that artist is inspired, or this author of this book is inspired. But we would say, wait a minute, inspiration actually means, for the Bible, in terms of the Bible, it means that this is God-breathed. And so this is the God himself communicating to us through inspiration. And so, as you said, we need to make sure, like, just because somebody says the Bible is inspired, we need to say, well, wait a minute, let's define this inspired.
So we have historic doctrines being reinterpreted.
We do.
We have key historic theological terms being redefined.
That's right.
What's the last one?
The heart of the gospel message shifts from sin and redemption to social justice. We've talked about social justice quite a bit here. And So they would say, as you said before, they would also say, now Jesus becomes our ultimate example of who to follow. There is an atonement theory. It's called the moral atonement theory. And so we have a moral example in Christ to follow. And to be sure, that's true. We do want to follow Christ. Like, that is what the Bible says. But we're not following Christ to be saved. We're following Christ because we are saved. And so it is a completely different gospel, which I think I see you turning to Galatians there. And so what does Paul say about this in Galatians?
Yeah, this is the very thing that Paul addressed in Galatians 1, verse 6. I'm amazed that you are so quickly deserting him who called you by the grace of Christ for a different gospel, which is really not another. Only there are some who are disturbing you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. But even though we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to that which we have preached to you, let him be accursed. And then verse 9, as we've said before, so I say again now, if any man is preaching to you a gospel contrary to that which you receive, let him be accursed. I mean, he doesn't mince his words here.
It's anathema.
You are damned, he says, if you change the true gospel message into a gospel message that does not save. And I think what you're getting at here is there's a shift from that true saving gospel of Jesus Christ to a social justice gospel, to a gospel liberation theology, where in the case of progressive Christians, they see the gospel as something that rescues you from oppression.
That's right.
Something that overturns power structures, something that rights all wrongs in a society, something where, you know, if you're in the oppressed class, then you need to be liberated from that oppressed class. And the way that that happens is the oppressors need to repent of their oppression, and you need to be given, you know, opportunities to advance beyond your levels of oppression. That's the gospel now in progressive circles. That is not the gospel of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
And that will not save anybody.
That's right. And essentially, you could lump it in underneath that cultural Marxism as well. Because they do want to bring justice, not real justice, but their perceived justice in helping the oppressed. So they would say, shifting from sin and redemption to social justice, they would say, follow your path. So when you read on the many of these progressive Christian websites, now, to be honest, I only read a few. I didn't read all of them because it was very redundant. But it was, if you're a Buddhist, if you're a Hindu, if you're a Mormon, we all have our paths that God has opened our eyes to. And whatever path that we are following, that's a path that leads to God. And it's unfortunate because they're leading people astray. And even for bringing them into their own place and they're saying, here's the Bible and here's how to get to God. Well, they're once again pushing a social works-based system. And really, there's nothing new under the sun. Right. And so they're saying if you can work hard enough, it's going back to what Martin Luther fought against, right? If you do enough good works, then you're going to go into heaven.
Yeah, that's the key for them. It's not what you believe, it's what you do.
That's right.
Action supersedes belief. So in their ideals, they believe it's more important to be active in social justice issues than it is about what you believe about the true gospel.
That's
and
right.
So for them, it's action, it's activism. Those are the key parts of progressive Christianity. And so unfortunately, the true gospel has been left in the dust when that happens.
And that goes back to, you said, Satan twists it just a little bit. We would also be promoting doing works, but not
Absolutely.
From the social justice standpoint.
Absolutely.
So if you come into the church and we say, yeah, you know, the Christian does need to care for the homeless and the widows
Absolutely.
And the orphans, and we do need to be helping people and standing up against abortion and these things, I absolutely agree.
Yes.
But we're doing it from the gospel, like we're saved, so now we're going out and doing these
things. That's not the gospel.
That's not the gospel. That's correct. And so then how has, we'll just briefly got about 3 to 5 minutes left. We'll look at two more things. First of all, how has the culture come into the church? And so how, because this is our culture that we live in. You know, there is no denying it. You can go to any major city now, still some smaller towns probably haven't been affected by this, but we see the CRT being taught in classes, you have BLM signs everywhere you go. And so you see the rainbow flags in June, that abomination of month. My birthday's in June, so it really hurts me. thanks. And so you now see this movement. It's everywhere. Like, you can't go anywhere without it. Now that's in the church. And, you know, as I was thinking about this, how did we get this culture into the church? I think, first of all, we didn't realize that there's actual sheep, wolves in sheep clothing. And so we've allowed anybody in that's called themselves a Christian because we don't want to offend anybody. So if you call yourself a Christian, you've got your Bible in your hand, you can walk into a church and everyone's going to start listening to you and treat you like that, even when you're starting to kind of give away your position on these things. So we just don't know our Bibles. We don't know that there are people out there that are trying to harm Christianity and bring down the churches and are attacking the churches.
Yeah, and I think added to that is the fact that progressive Christians want to saddle up to culture.
Right.
Whereas historically, Christians have tried to distance themselves from the world, right? We as believers throughout the millennia have tried to avoid the world. We've tried to not be conformed to this world. We know that enmity or friendship with the world is enmity with God. And so there's been this whole doctrine of separation where we've not tried to live this monastic.
But that was the extreme. Right?
That was the extreme of that. Right. That's not it. It's just we don't want to be conformed to this world. And so progressive Christians will have a different mindset.
That's right.
They want to saddle up to what's going on in the culture. They want to be sensitive to where the culture's at. So when you start hearing of, you know, a wokeness in the culture or the BLM movement or the LGBT movement or the transgender movement, all of that stuff is now culturally relevant and important. And so progressive Christians see that and say, hey, we need to get on board with those things.
That's right.
So it's the very opposite of what Orthodox Christianity has done throughout the ages.
That's good. And then we'll close with this. How can we respond? I think it's important to understand how we can respond as a church, because first of all, we need to know the truth. We have God on our side. And it's not God wrestling with these people, right? It's God's already won. The battle's done. You can read Revelation. We can see the ending, right? So it's not like, I wonder what's going to happen. Jesus said he'll build his church. The gates of Hades aren't going to stand against it. So we're not worried about the church failing. As you said it earlier, there's always going to be a remnant. So all of these things. So how can we, as individual believers, how are we able to stand, whether it be in our workplace, whether it be our families? First and foremost, we need to know how to do that.
I think we just need to do the basics. We need to continue hiding God's word in our heart. We need to be continuing to be equipped in, you know, just the historic doctrines of the Christian faith. We need to be increasingly convinced of the power of the gospel. Mm. Paul says in Romans 1, I'm not ashamed of that gospel. But I think too, we've spoken fairly strongly here. I think we need to temper all of this with love and
Absolutely.
Kindness. We don't want to be the doctrine police, and we don't want to, you know, head out and chop people's heads off in the name of trying to defend the truth. No, even we need to be gracious and kind.
That's right.
And when we have conversations with people who are more progressive, we need to be gentle, and we need to be winsome, and we need to show them the love of Christ even in how we deal with them.
Yeah, so we need to be ready to give an answer by knowing the truth, but we also need to season that answer with grace as we're talking to them. And so I would just encourage you to continue to read your Bible, know these doctrines that we hold to in our historic faith, because these are the doctrines that are under attack. So know how to explain penal substitutionary atonement, understand the deity of Christ, understand what hell is and why it has to exist in the framework of how God has set this up. So anyway, I hope this has been helpful for you guys. And we continue to pray that the Lord would sustain us, and that, Lord, we would be brave, and that our church would continue to be a beacon of light in the midst of a extremely more and more hostile culture that is seemingly coming after Christians and churches. And just continue to pray for our brothers and sisters that are facing this persecution, that they may stand strong too. So. This NBC Pastor Podcast, we are available in video, Facebook, and YouTube. We have audio formats on most of the podcast apps, iTunes, Spotify, Google Podcasts. So if you guys want to check out any other content that we have, you can go to nbcmi.org. And if you want to see our podcast, you can just click on the tab there and check us out. So hope you guys have a wonderful rest of the week, and we look forward to seeing you again next week.